prose. What is also interesting is she has been an editor, has worked with many other writers who write. So there is that perspective, her own writing, working with other writers. Also, you all have perhaps seen the movie Dhanak, which, as you know, is a movie, but in a reverse process, she made it into a novel. So that's an interesting thing to talk about, or at least know about, where somebody else has scripted a movie and it has been taken back to be made into a novel. So what was the process? How difficult is it as her, as a writer, using somebody else's writing to make it into a novel, let's say. So I'll leave it to Anushka to talk to you. We'll have her talk to us first, and then she'll be willing to take as many questions as you have about your own writing, things that you've been worried about in the last 2 days. Many of those questions have come up. So we'll have an interaction also at the end of it, a long discussion. So,
thank you. Yeah, so what I was thinking is that first we'll just talk about what you've been doing in the past 2 days. I'd like to know what you've been writing, what you've learned. And I'll also talk to you a little bit about my own writing and how the things that I find difficult and what their problems and how I get over them and things like that. Then you can ask me questions. And I thought the second half, what you can do is if you'd like that, you can each of you read one piece that you've written in the past 2 days. And we can talk about it, I can give you feedback on it. Would you like that? So we'll do that in the second half, right?
You can read your poetry which you have
written. Yeah, poem, whatever. You can choose which piece to read. You can either choose the poem that you've written or the story or a bit of it, anything, yeah. I thought preferably in the last 2 days, since you would have written it taking the inputs that you got in the last 2 days. Huh? So then we can take it from there. So it'll be kind of us. I mean, it's also useful to hear the feedback for others because it makes you understand how to work on your own thing. So all of you are kind of emptying my mind. If there are no phone calls, no hotel, it's quiet and you can write. Some people write, need complete isolation to write, which I do. Whereas some people can write anywhere. I've heard somebody tell me this about Amita. You've all heard of Amita Ghosh? So I've heard it said about him that his first novel, when he was writing it, he was studying in London at the time. And you know, they're all young college kids, and they used to all be partying. All the rest of his friends would be sitting around partying, and he'd be sitting in the corner in the middle of the party and writing his book. So you know, there are all kinds of writers. People who want to write are usually obsessed about writing. So what I'm going to do is just ask you guys just to understand how you all approach writing. That why do you write? What is it about writing that excites you? Why have you come to this workshop to learn ways of writing? Would like to tell you. Yeah.
Writing is a thing where we can actually isolate ourselves from the rest of the world, where we can think what we are thinking, and we can actually gain some peace of mind. And it's writing is something where we can isolate ourselves from rest of the thoughts or rest of the world, and we can get peace and calmness in our own self, and we can pour our emotions out in some or the other way.
So are you talking about writing poetry kind of thing?
Or no, actually.
Anything. But even if stories,
like painters paint to isolate and calm themselves, to pour their emotions in that way. Hmm. Writers write so that they can pour their emotions in that way. Like every person has their own ways, and writing is something where
we can
pull out.
But you write stories.
Yes.
So that's interesting. From writing is so writing is kind of the word is catharsis, where you get your emotions out by writing. You can also do it through fiction. You can also, but poetry is the more expressive form in that sense. Poetry is the closest to painting in that sense, because poetry and painting are both something that is, you're expressing your emotions. But you know, you can also, short story also, you can bring out all your emotions by And in fact, it's a very good way to also resolve, reading and writing both. It's a good way to resolve problems in your mind, because when you're writing it out, you sometimes, you have to think things through in a way that, in creative ways, that then help you solve the things that are bothering you. Yeah.
And sometimes, at least in my case, I feel that you can create your own worlds while writing. You can take things from your imagination and get it out. A lot of times I find it's hard to draw or paint something, but writing it out in words, I find it's easier.
Yeah, so very similar, but in this case, I think about creating new worlds and new characters, which is half the fun of writing, I think. Yeah.
What I find the best about writing is it doesn't have to be real. It can be anything. And that I really enjoy writing anything. It's just out of this world, totally different.
It doesn't have to be real. So you can just make up anything you like.
You can use your imagination.
You don't have to live in the reality that is around you. Yeah.
That is what excites me to write. So I feel, for me, poetry is very much close to my heart, because I feel it allows me to express whatever I feel. It connects me and the world. Whatever I feel, whatever I wish to express to the world, comes out through poetry. So I think I am more poetry.
Comparing writing and drawing, so you're saying that you like to write about things that actually happened to you, because that helps you kind of analyze what has happened to you during the day. Okay.
When you just imagine, you start imagining things. When you talk about your friend, I just imagine that people talking, there are elves and fairies there. They would say, "Are you kidding me? Just concentrate on your work." Writing is a kind of way that I can express my feelings. What I imagine, what I get gripped by, those ideas, I can write them down and just express them with other people.
Okay, so you feel that when you talk about things with your friends, sometimes they don't accept the more weird thing that you want to talk about. Then you can do it with writing. Yeah.
In my case, I feel that most of the times I write, then they get to talk or something. I love writing because I can change that topic, even if it's a very serious topic. I love to change it into funny, and everybody loves that thing. So I love writing because of that.
So basically, you feel you can control things, because you're told to do something boring, but with your writing, you can make it fun and exciting. Yeah. So that's actually one of the things about writing, because you can create your own whatever world that you want, which is pretty much what all of you have said. Anything else? Any other thing that excites anybody about writing? No? That's it? Yeah.
Pinpoint
the wrongs. So you like to use your writing to point out the wrongs in society and to highlight what is wrong with society, and you also suggest ways to set them right or not. You just like to highlight, which is very important. Yeah.
Not personally, but some people also use writing as a tool to get a message across or to spread ideas.
It is pretty much what she's saying, that, to get the message across about what is wrong in society. So all these are reasons where most people write. But one of the reasons, which in addition to all this, this is also why I write a lot of poetry, I write a lot of verse, because I just love creating those rhythms and creating that music with words. So you guys did a bit of poetry writing before yesterday, right? So when you're writing poetry, it doesn't always have to rhyme, but it still has to have its own bit of music. The music may come just from using the right word in the right place. Sometimes makes something, you know, that it no other word will do. I think that's what about writing really excites me, in addition to all the things that you said, because of course writing helps you, but just as reading does, it helps you escape into your own world, it helps you also have control sometimes, that really helps, because sometimes as a child especially, your world is completely, everything that happens around you is decided by the adults around you, right? So you sometimes feel sometimes that you have no power because everything is decided by your teachers are telling you what to do, your parents are telling you what to do. So, but when you write, you tell your characters what to do. So it gives you a sense of control which you don't get, which you may not have in the real world. So apart, but like I said, apart from all these, one of the things I really love about writing, about why I love writing, is because I love words. And that's, I'll just read out a couple of poems that I've brought.
It's a bit of a poem from Alfred Lord Tennyson's The Eagle, right? So what I love about it is that through words, like somebody was saying, it's sometimes difficult to draw, right? But just through words, he's created such a beautiful picture that you just picture the scene in your mind just through the words that he's written. It's called The Eagle. So imagine this, okay? Imagine he's talking about an eagle. He clasps the crag with crooked hands, close to the sun in lonely lands. Ringed with the azure world he stands, the wrinkled sea beneath him crawls. He watches from his mountain walls, and like a thunderbolt he falls. So isn't that, can you just imagine the eagle sitting up there? And just the lovely words that are used, like the wrinkled sea. So you know, you look at the sea and when there are lots of waves rippling through the sea, it looks like wrinkles. So that's what a poet does. No? The thing about poetry is that you find a word that is kind of surprising. You won't think of the sea as wrinkles, right? It's a metaphor. Because when you're thinking of, did you talk about metaphors in your thing with poetry? Right. So it's a metaphor because you usually associate wrinkles with a person, right? Wrinkled skin. Old people or whatever, but then you suddenly take that adjective wrinkle and you apply it to something completely different, which is the sea, and that surprise, and it just gives you such a beautiful image in your mind of the sea being wrinkled and the eagle sitting there and then the eagle falling like a thunderbolt. So that's what's exciting about writing, the way that you can use words. You can use simple words that are, you know, they're just lying there doing nothing and being themselves, and you can take them and make them be something completely different. And that's so exciting, yeah.
Some of you must have read this poem in your textbook.
Many and many poetic devices. For example, the line you read had metaphor, had personification, had imagery, had transfer deficit at a place.
Sorry, that?
Transfer deficit. So, multiple...
That's a very... transfer deficit. That's
yeah,
a very...
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's... it's fine. She's just applying
so in subsequent phrases, we can good. See use of multiple...
Right. So as a poet, you don't need to know all these terms, right? As a poet, as a student you do. But as a poet, it doesn't matter if you don't know what transferred epithet is, so don't worry about it. Okay, it's just that you learn what you do when you keep writing. And it only comes from writing a lot and from reading a lot, that you learn to make words your tools, you know? So you don't have to use words only in the way that you've seen them used. You find new ways of using words, and that's the excitement of writing poetry.
Sometimes even invents words which don't really exist, but they get like a sense, like scrumptious, not scrumptious, scrumptious is the word, but like he like for describing delicious things.
Yeah, if you've heard of Lewis Carroll,
yeah.
He does that a lot. So in fact, there's a whole poem called Jabberwocky,
yes.
In which he does this constantly. So that brings us to, I'll just come back to this here.
topic is squirrel. So it has a line like this. The squirrel bears a tail. But the poet has used it has a tail. He has written it bears a tail instead of it has a tail. So, ma'am, we can use different words with to describe somebody.
That's what it's surprising. Also, it's surprising that why wouldn't we say a squirrel has a tail? It is a boring way to say it. Whereas, when it wears a tail, it makes it also gives the tail a completely different. You look at the tail differently now. It's like something that the squirrel is wearing. It's like adding to the squirrel's look, outfit. Yeah.
I'm like, it's a movie like me, but it was thrilling and just like it's a movie.
You know the whole poem?
Yes.
Can you recite it for us?
It was brillig and the slithy serves did gyre and gimble in the wave. All mimsy were the borogoves and the mome rats outgrabe. Beware the jabberwock, my son, the claws that catch, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the jubjub bird and shun, the frumious bandersnatch.
Right, that's all. So,
it goes on, but so there's so many words in it, like you said, which are just completely new. There's no such word as frumious. There's no such word as jabberwocky for that. Yeah, you were going to say something.
Still, like, we get that meaning, what he's trying to say. Even though we don't know the words, we get to know that what he's trying to express through that poem.
So it's so the poem has completely made up words. There's nothing like brillig, no? There's nothing like slithy toads. But still, it was brillig and the slithy toads. Did gyre and gimble in the way. All mimsy were the borogoves. And moon rates outgrabe. You get a feeling of what he's trying to do with the poem. He's trying to scare you. Beware the jabberwock, my son. The jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the jubjub bird and shun the frumious bandersnatch. Completely meaningless, but you still get a sense of something scary just by the way the words are put together, by the way the words sound. Like a word like frumious, we mean something different from a word like, splish, gum. You know, just the sound of the word makes you get a certain feeling. Right? So that's the fun of it. Yeah.
In our school, our teacher had given us a poem. It's till now it's my favorite poem. So it was written by, I think, Kedarnath Agarwal. It was called the, it was about the spring wind. But the way he had written it, he said one line that main anokhi hawa hu, which made me want to read that poem. It was a very long poem and I thought that I would be bored. I would read only one or two stanzas, and but the time that time came, I said that I should read further.
What do you think he meant by that? What is it that appealed to you about?
That meant, for me, that meant that it was the wind of the spring. It was not any wind, it was only the spring wind.
So yeah, so sometimes it's just a little phrase that can draw you into somebody's writing. Just a little word, like I said, used in a surprising way, which is what she found with Anokhi Hawa, and made her want to read the whole poem. So that's really what words do. And yeah, somebody else had their hand raised over here. Okay, so to come to this Frumious Bandersnatch stuff. So nonsense verse is something that I've been writing for a long time. I got hooked into nonsense verse because of Lewis Carroll. You read Alice, right? So there's a lot of really fun nonsense verse in that. Like this, the story itself is fairly nonsensical. It's actually easier to write nonsense verse than to write nonsense prose. But some of those poems are just so brilliant, like The Walrus and the Carpenter, and there's another. I mean, it's full of these. Old Father William. That's also one.
The Song of the Night.
Song of the Night. Yeah. So it's full of those who don't know where to start. Right, now that's something that a lot of people struggle with, like I was saying. So the common way to start is once upon a time or a long time ago, which really is boring. So the usual, a very standard rule that most writers follow is that you try and start as late as possible. So you start preferably with some action. So what is the central action in your story? Try and start from there. So after we do this, I have some examples of openings, and I also have a small exercise on how you can try, you know, to try out an opening sentence. We'll do that later, right? So here we have five possible situations. So you have to put yourself in one, the shoes of one of these, you have to choose one. So either you are practicing for a big race, for a really big race. So you're an athlete. So imagine that you're an athlete and you have a big race coming up. And you've been working for months and months and months to win that race. It may be your school race or maybe an inter-school competition, and there is one particular, in the place of somebody who's gone through that. Or you can choose this one, which is that you're an actor and suddenly you go on stage and you forget your lines. And you really want to be, like, you think that you're going to be the star of the show, and you go on stage and you forget your lines. Well, they want to make them. So, disliking too much, I don't know, has been adopted. Or you have found out that you are adopted.
You have found that you have been adopted? Yesterday night, I found that I have been adopted. Yesterday and today, I am sad. Yesterday, I cried a lot. Yesterday, I closed myself in a room. Yesterday night, I found I have been adopted. That's what I would say. Yesterday night, I found that I have been adopted. Yesterday night and today, I'm feeling very distressed. Yesterday, I cried a lot. Yesterday, I closed myself in a room. Yesterday night, and I found that I have been adopted. That's what I
would say. I found out that I'm adopted. Family is by born and non-blood, wise men say. How beautiful human relations are, I used to believe. Now, I feel extremely hard to accept, losing yourself in the sea of love. There are so many creatures, big and scary, but I am just a new moon looking for home and discovering identity.
Gushing through my leg, my ankle is getting bigger and redder. But the pain in my heart is far more unbearable than the one which everyone can see. My sobs and tears are making my heart swell with agony. I know that I won't be able to even walk down the aisle, but my will in my heart is making it tough to believe. When the doctor came up and told me that I'm incapable of running down the track, it was as if my whirlwind stopped right there at that moment.
Option number one. Oh my God, what do I do now? My foot is paining so much. Also, my race is tomorrow. I have sprained my foot so badly that I can't walk properly, much less run. How do I win the race in this condition?
I said to my father, I'm sorry, father. Father said, why are you sorry? I said, because I lost your expensive pen. I'm sorry. Father said, what? You lost my expensive pen? I will not buy you any more pens.
You are an actor on stage and you suddenly forget your lines. Mowgli woman. It was Monday. I had been selected for stage play. I was acting as Mowgli. Then I wore my costume at school. Orange chaddi is jungle. We started the play at 7 o'clock or 7:30. Mine was the first part. I went on the stage. Then something pongy happened. I forgot my line. Forgot. Everybody started laughing. I think I should have chosen the last one.
Keep it short.
Everyone is clapping.
only for me. How can you do such a mistake? God, I have forgotten the end line of my short film. Is this a dream? Let me pinch my teeth. Ow! No, it isn't a dream. Now what should I do? All my fans will be very disappointed with me and will stop following me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram and Snapchat. Honestly, I practice a lot for this stage performance.
Forget your lines. It begins with a dialogue. This is your life and it's ending 1 minute at a time. It's ending, yes, as fast as ever until you stumble on the rock you call age, where everything stops till you fall back in time and freeze to those days of mangoes and berries and summer and childhood. Childhood until you forget your lines on stage and mess up your only chance to redeem yourself of the infinite opportunities when you flushed your cheeks red and prayed and prayed and prayed till you were dead. That's what I felt when the spotlights blurred out my vision and made me sick as a cow, ruined to dust amidst the finest of humanity who had paid to watch my show. That's the feeling you get when you forget your lines.
Soil is banned, and we were very close to what you said, so we have to go into the bathroom to change, and he's kind of hidden in the diapers in the bathroom, and he's sneaking out before the IR can see her, because seeing him, again, he'll get yelled at. So that's why he poked his head out of the last stall. Gave his khaki shorts one firm tuck to make sure everything inside was secure. Because he has to wear diapers again. So he has to make sure it's secure. And he peered around to see the posters. It's actually a very funny, fun story. It's a fun mystery story. But it's set in a school like that. So these things are just there as a part of their lives. Because these children, one is in a wheelchair, one is... You know, everybody has a different kind of disability. But the story is about, just about a mystery story. It's a school at school. But because it's set in a school like that, there are these little details. So, one last one. I thought she was sleeping. It was a relief to get up to silence after all that coughing during the past few days. What do you think?
It's a baby. It's like that. It's like that.
I thought she was sleeping. But how the book begins, you know. I thought she was sleeping. It was a relief to get up to silence after all that coughing during the past 2 days.
She was a deep patient. She was a deep patient. She was in
coma. Sorry?
Sorry?
Yeah, that is right. But the, yeah, what do you think of it? Are you just raising your arms because you're tired? Something said. You should dare to do it. You said. So that's exactly it. She
died of TB.
This is it's about a girl. It's called Wanting More. It starts with the girl's mother dying. So she wakes up to silence and she says the relief to wake up to silence after all the days of coughing. But then she realizes the silence is because her mother has died. And then, so it starts with the mother's death. It's a really sad that it comes down. So you get a sense of how a beginning can affect how you read a story, right? So I'm going to give you so chosen is like a young story so that everybody can do it. Because if I chose it like the older story, it will be possible. So the story is about a boy in a school. I don't know, have any of you read Peter Pumpkin? Peter Pumpkin? No. So you have, oh no. It doesn't matter, I'm sure you don't remember the question. So it's about this boy in a school who keeps eating all his friends' cooking boxes, basically. Because he's always hungry, always hungry. He comes to school with like millions of chicken boxes and he's eating throughout the whole day. By recess time he's finished off all his own dabbas and he starts eating his friends' dabbas. So the friends get fed up of him. They all gang up together and decide that they have to teach him a lesson. So the rest of the book is about how these friends are trying to find ways to get people to stop eating their chicken. And they succeed. So what they finally do, I'll tell you the end also because it's only the end of the book. So what they finally do is that they fill their dabbas with worms and things like that from the dictionary screen. And the kid that bar in the bag, knowing that Peter is going to try and steal it, so he steals the dabba and tries to eat it and gets so grossed out that he stops eating it. So that's the story. So what I want you to do is to think about it, since this is the whole story, think about it and write the first two or three lines. How would you start the story if you were writing the story? How would you start it? What would be the first two or three lines? And like I said, start as late as possible, start writing the story.
Does
everybody
have paper?
Write down the sentences. You want to?
Everybody's
point. You can write up. So remember your story now. You can write it from Peter's point of view. You can write it from a friend's point of view. You can write it from an outside point of view. Anything. Yeah. His name was actually Pushkin, but they call him Peter Pumpkin. You can change the name, don't worry about it. Pushkin. His name is Pushkin.